नाउ इकोलॉजी, इकोलॉजी इज अ साइंटिफिक स्टडी ऑफ द रेसिप्रोकल रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन ऑर्गेनिजम्स. दीज ऑर्गेनिजम्स विल इंक्लूड माइक्रोब्स, प्लांट्स, एनिमल्स एंड मैन. सो इकोलॉजी इज अ साइंटिफिक स्टडी ऑफ द रेसिप्रोकल रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन ऑर्गेनिजम्स विद देयर एनवायरमेंट. इट डील्स विद द वेज इन विच ऑर्गेनिजम्स आर मोल्डेड बाई देयर एनवायरमेंट, हाउ दे मेक यूज ऑफ एनवायरमेंटल रिसोर्सेज इंक्लूडिंग एनर्जी फ्लो एंड मिनरल साइक्लिंग. द टर्म इकोलॉजी वॉज कॉइंड ओनली एज लेट एज 1868. इट हैज बीन डिराइव फ्रॉम टू ग्रीक वर्ड्स, नेमली Oikos, OIKOS, which means home or place to live in, and the second word is Logos, LOGOS, which means study. Literally, it is the study of the home of nature. Ecology is defined as a scientific study of the relationship of the living organisms with each other and with their environment. History of ecology. The roots of ecology lie in natural history, which is as old as human civilization itself. Since early history, man has indulged in ecology in a practical sort of way, knowingly and unknowingly. In primitive society, every individual was required to have an intimate knowledge of his environment for their survival. That is about the forces of nature and of plants and animals around him. Our ancient Indian texts have references to ecological principles. The classical texts of the Vedic period, such as Vedas, the Samhitas, the Brahmanas and the Aranyakas, Upanishads, contain many references to ecological concepts. The Indian treatise on medicine, also known as Charaka Samhita, CharakaSamhita, and the surgical text known as Susruta Samhita, SusrutaSamhita, show that people during this period had a good understanding of plant and animal ecology. These texts contain classification of animals on the basis of habit and habitat, land in terms of nature of soil, climate and vegetation, and description of plants typical to various localities. Charak Samhita contains information that land, air, water and seasons were indispensable for life, and that polluted air and water were injurious for health. Environment. Everything that surrounds or affects an organism during its lifetime is collectively known as its environment, which comprises both living, biotic and non-living, abiotic components. All organisms from virus to man are obligatorily dependent on the environment for food, energy, water, oxygen, shelter and for other needs. The environment is defined as the sum total of living, non-living components, influences and events and which are surrounding an organism. The environment is defined as the sum total of all living and non-living components, influences and events surrounding an organism. Now, concept of environment. The relationship and interaction between organism and environment are highly complex. No organism can live alone without interacting with other organisms. So each organism has other organisms as a part of its environment. Each and everything with which we interact or which we need for our sustenance forms our environment. The environment is not static. Both biotic and abiotic factors are in a flux and keep changing continuously. Now, components of an environment. The components of an environment are divided into two parts, abiotic components and biotic components. Now, what are these abiotic components and biotic components, we will know after we will see what particular elements come under abiotic components and what particular elements come under biotic components. Under abiotic components comes the energy, radiation, then temperature and heat flow, then water, then atmospheric gases and wind, then fire, then gravity, then topography, then soil. In biotic components comes green plants, then comes non-green plants, then comes decomposers, then comes parasites, then comes symbionts, then comes animals, then comes man. So basically you can say that abiotic components are those components which are non-living, and biotic components are those components which are living. Now an interesting fact. Diesel engines exhaust fumes can cause cancer in humans, and it belongs to the same potentially deadly category as asbestos, arsenic and mustard gas. This information is sourced from World Health Organization, June 2012. Now for instance, let's take the environment of a fish in a pond. External environment of fish. Its environment consists of abiotic components such as light, temperature, including the water in which nutrients, oxygen, other gases and organic matter are dissolved. Now the biotic environment of the fish consists of microscopic organisms called plankton, as well as aquatic plants and animals and decomposers. Now we'll discuss of internal environment of a fish. It is enclosed by the outer body surface. Then the internal environment is relatively stable as compared to external environment. Then, however, it is not absolutely constant. Injury, illness or excessive stress upsets the internal environment. Next, for example, if a marine fish is transferred to a freshwater environment, it will not be able to survive. So these we talked about with an example about the external environment of a fish and the internal environment of a fish. Now, levels of organizations in ecology. The main levels of organization of ecology are 6 and are as follows. Now these 6 levels of organization of ecology are: first is the individual level, second is population level, third is community level, fourth is ecosystem level, fifth is biome level and sixth is biosphere level. Now we will look at these level one by one. First we'll look at the individual level. Organism in an individual living being that has the ability to act or function independently. Organism is an individual living being that has the ability to act or function independently. It may be plant, an animal, bacterium, fungi, etc. It is a body made up of organs, then organelles, organelles, or other parts that work together to carry on the various processes of life. Next is the population level. Population is a group of organisms, usually of the same species, occupying a defined area during a specific time. Population growth rate is a percentage variation between the number of individuals in a population at 2 different times. Therefore, the population growth rate can be positive or negative. The main factors that make population grow are birth and immigration. The main factors that make population decrease are death and emigration. Immigration, that is immigration, it means people influxing from one area to another area. So if people are coming into an area, it is being said that they are immigrating, that is immigration, which makes the population grow. Conversely, if a population decreases, we can say that emigration is the reason for that. That is emigration. Emigration means people going out of a particular area, or you can say organisms going out of a particular area or niche or habitat or anything. Next, the main limiting factors for the growth of a population are biotic and abiotic components. Population density is the relation between the number of individuals of a population and the area they occupy. Now, community. If we look around ourselves, we will notice that population of plants and animals seldom occur by themselves. The reason for this is quite obvious. In order to survive, individuals of any one species depend on the individuals of different species with which they actively interact in several ways. For example, animals require plants for food and trees for shelter. प्लांट्स रिक्वायर्स एनिमल्स फॉर पॉलिनेशन, सीड डिस्पर्सल एंड सॉयल माइक्रो ऑर्गेनिज्म टू फैसिलिटेट न्यूट्रिएंट सप्लाई. नाउ कम्युनिटीज इन मोस्ट इंस्टेंसेज आर नेम्ड आफ्टर द डोमिनेंट प्लांट फॉर्म, दैट इज स्पेशीज. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, अ ग्रास लैंड कम्युनिटी इज डोमिनेटेड बाई ग्रासेस, दो इट मे कंटेन हर्ब्स, श्रब्स एंड ट्रीज अलॉन्ग विद एसोसिएटेड एनिमल्स ऑफ डिफरेंट स्पेशीज. अ कम्युनिटी इज नॉट फिक्स्ड और रिजिड, कम्युनिटीज में बी लार्ज और स्मॉल. अ शॉर्ट नोट, द स्काईज SKIES ओवर नॉर्थ इंडिया आर सीजनली फिल्ड विद अ थुक सूप ऑफ एरोसोल पार्टिकल्स ऑल अलॉन्ग द साउदर्न एज ऑफ द हिमालयाज, बांग्लादेश एंड बे ऑफ बंगाल. नाउ नेक्स्ट वी विल डिस्कस टाइप्स ऑफ कम्युनिटी ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ साइज एंड डिग्री ऑफ रिलेटिव इंडिपेंडेंस. कम्युनिटीज में बी डिवाइडेड इंटू टू टाइप्स. फर्स्ट इज द मेजर कम्युनिटी, सेकेंड इज द माइनर कम्युनिटी. नाउ वी विल डिस्कस वॉट इज द मेजर कम्युनिटी. दीज आर लार्ज साइज, वेल ऑर्गेनाइज एंड रिलेटिवली इंडिपेंडेंट. दे डिपेंड ओनली ऑन द सन्स एनर्जी फ्रॉम आउटसाइड एंड आर इंडिपेंडेंट ऑफ द इनपुट्स एंड आउटपुट्स फ्रॉम एडजेसेंट कम्युनिटीज. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, ट्रॉपिकल एवरग्रीन फॉरेस्ट इन द नॉर्थ ईस्ट. नेक्स्ट इज माइनर कम्युनिटीज. दीज आर डिपेंडेंट ऑन नेबरिंग कम्युनिटीज एंड आर ऑफन कॉल्ड सोसाइटीज. दे आर सेकेंडरी एग्रीगेशंस विद इन अ मेजर कम्युनिटी एंड आर नॉट देयरफॉर कंप्लीटली इंडिपेंडेंट यूनिट्स एज फार एज एनर्जी एंड न्यूट्रिएंट डायनेमिक्स आर कंसर्न. फॉर एग्जाम्पल, अ मैट ऑफ लिचन ऑन अ काउ डंग पैड. नाउ विल डिस्कस स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ अ कम्युनिटी. इन अ कम्युनिटी द नंबर ऑफ स्पेशीज एंड साइज ऑफ देयर पॉपुलेशन वेरी ग्रेटली, दैट इज दे आर वेरी मच डिफरेंट. अ कम्युनिटी मे हैव वन और सेवरल स्पेशीज. द इन्वायरमेंटल फैक्टर्स डिटरमिन द कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स ऑफ द कम्युनिटी एज वेल एज द पैटर्न ऑफ द ऑर्गेनाइजेशन ऑफ द मेंबर्स इन द कम्युनिटी. द कैरेक्टरिस्टिक पैटर्न ऑफ द कम्युनिटी इज टर्म्ड एज स्ट्रक्चर, विच इज रिफ्लेक्टेड इन द रोल्स प्लेड बाई वेरियस पॉपुलेशन, देयर रेंज, द टाइप ऑफ एरिया दे इनहैबिट, द डाइवर्सिटी ऑफ स्पेशीज इन द कम्युनिटी एंड द स्पेक्ट्रम ऑफ इंटरैक्शंस बिटवीन देम. नाउ वी विल डिस्कस द फोर्थ लेवल ऑफ इकोलॉजी, द फोर्थ लेवल ऑफ ऑर्गेनाइजेशन इन इकोलॉजी, विच इज द इकोसिस्टम. दिस इज द फोर्थ वन. द फर्स्ट वन वॉज इंडिविजुअल, विच वी हैव डिस्कस्ड, पॉपुलेशन वी हैव डिस्कस्ड, कम्युनिटी वी हैव डिस्कस्ड. नाउ वी विल डिस्कस इकोसिस्टम. एन इकोसिस्टम इज डिफाइंड एज अ स्ट्रक्चरल एंड फंक्शनल यूनिट ऑफ बायोस्फीयर कंसिस्टिंग ऑफ कम्युनिटी ऑफ लिविंग बींग्स एंड द फिजिकल इन्वायरमेंट बोथ इंटरैक्टिंग एंड एक्सचेंजिंग मटेरियल्स बिटवीन देम. An ecosystem is a complex set of relationship among the living resources. Habitats and residents of an area. It includes plants, trees, animals, fishes, birds, microorganisms, water, soil and people. Ecosystems vary greatly in size and elements, but each is a functioning unit of nature. Everything that lives in an ecosystem is dependent on the other species. And animals and any elements that are also part of that ecological community. Everything that lives in an ecosystem is dependent on the other species and element that are also a part of that ecological community. If one part of the ecosystem is damaged or disappears, it has an impact on everything else. When an ecosystem is healthy, that is sustainable, it means that all the elements live in balance and are capable of reproducing themselves. Ecosystem can be as small as a single tree or as large as an entire forest. Now, components of ecosystem. The components of ecosystem is categorized into biotic of living components and abiotic of non-living components, which I have already told you earlier that biotic are living components and abiotic are non-living components. Both the components of ecosystem and environment are same. First, we'll discuss abiotic components. Abiotic components are the inorganic or non-living parts of the world. The abiotic part consists of soil, water, air and light, energy, etc. It also involves a large number of chemicals like oxygen, nitrogen, etc. and physical processes including volcanoes, earthquakes, floods, forest fires, climates and weather conditions. Abiotic factors are the most important determinants of where and how well an organism exists in its environment. Although these factors interact with each other, one single factor can limit the range of an organism. Now, first we will discuss the first abiotic component, which is energy. Energy from the sun is essential for the maintenance of life. In case of plants, the sun directly supplies the necessary energy. Since animals cannot use solar energy directly, they obtain it indirectly by eating. Plants or animals or both. Energy determines the distribution of organisms in the environment. Next abiotic component is rainfall. Water is essential for all living beings. Majority of biochemical reactions take place in an aqueous medium. Water helps to regulate body temperature. Further, water bodies form the habitat for many aquatic plants and animals. Next abiotic component is temperature. Temperature is a critical factor of the environment, which greatly influences survival of organisms. Organism can tolerate only a certain range of temperature and humidity. Next abiotic component is atmosphere. The Earth's atmosphere is responsible for creating conditions suitable for the existence of a healthy biosphere on this planet. It is made up of 21% oxygen, then 78% nitrogen, then 0.038% carbon dioxide, and then other inert gases, that is 0.93% argon, neon, etc. Now, next abiotic component is substratum, substratum. Now, it is a land. Land is covered by soil and a wide variety of microbes, protozoa, fungi, and small elements, which are also called as invertebrates. These all elements thrive in the soil of land. Now, roots of plants pierce through the soil to tap water and nutrients. Organisms can be terrestrial or aquatic. Terrestrial, which means those organisms which live on land, and aquatic, which means those organisms which live in water. Now, terrestrial animals live on land. Aquatic plants, animals, and microbes live in fresh water as well as in the sea. Some microbes live even in the hot water vents which are under the sea. Now, next abiotic component is materials. First part of the material is organic components such as proteins, carbohydrates, lipids, humic substances are formed from inorganic compound on decomposition. Second type of materials are inorganic compounds such as carbon, carbon dioxide, water, sulfur, nitrates, phosphates, and ions of various metals are essential for organisms to survive. Next abiotic component is latitude and altitude. Latitude has a strong influence on an area's temperature, resulting in change of climate, such as polar, tropical, and temperate. These climates determine different natural biomes. From sea level to highest peaks, wildlife is influenced by altitude. As the altitude increases, the air becomes colder and drier, affecting wildlife accordingly. Now, we will talk about biotic components. Till now, we were talking about abiotic components. Now, we will talk about biotic components. Biotic components include living organisms comprising plants, animals, and microbes, and are classified according to their functional attributes into producers and consumers. Now, the very first component of biotic component is the primary producers, which are also known as autotrophs. Spelling is autotrophs, autotrophs, which are also known by the name of self-nourishing. Now, primary producers are basically green plants, and they also include certain bacteria and algae. Next, they synthesize carbohydrate from simple inorganic raw materials like carbon dioxide and water in the presence of sunlight by the process of photosynthesis for themselves, and supply indirectly to other non-producers. Next, in terrestrial ecosystem, in producers are basically herbaceous, herbaceous, and woody plants, while in aquatic ecosystem, producers are various species of microscopic algae. I will again repeat this point. In terrestrial ecosystem, producers are basically herbaceous and woody plants. While in aquatic ecosystems, producers are various species of microscopic algae. Now, what is herbaceous? H-E-R-B-A-C-E-O-U-S. It means denoting or relating to herbs in the botanical sense. Now, next subtype of the biotic components is consumers. Heterotrophs or phagotrophs. Consumers, also known as heterotrophs, H-E-T-E-R-O-T-R-O-P-H-S, and also known by the name of phagotrophs, P-H-A-G-O-T-R-O-P-H-S. Now, consumers are incapable of producing their own food. That is, they cannot do photosynthesis. So, these consumers depend on organic food derived from plants, animals, or both. Consumers can be divided into two broad groups, namely micro-consumers and macro-consumers. M-I-C-R-O, that is micro, and M-A-C-R-O, that is macro-consumers. Now, first we will discuss macro-consumers, M-A-C-R-O. Now, they feed on plants or animals or both and are characterized on the basis of their food resources. Next, herbivores are primary consumers which feed mainly on plants, for example, cow, rabbit. Secondary consumers feed on primary consumers, for example, wolves. Which were those primary consumers? They were cow, rabbit, etc. Next, carnivores which feed on secondary consumers. Carnivores which feed on secondary consumers are called tertiary consumers, for example, lions, which can eat wolves. Next, omnivores are organisms which consume both plants and animals, for example, man. So, these were macro consumers, M-A-C-R-O. Now, we will discuss micro consumers, M-I-C-R-O. They are also known as saprotrophs, S-A-P-R-O-T-R-O-P-H-S. Saprotrophs, also known as decomposers or osmotrophs, O-S-M-O-T-R-O-P-H-S. Now, they are bacteria and fungi which obtain energy and nutrients by decomposing dead organic substances, which is also known as detritus, D-E-T-R-I-T-U-S. Dead organic substance is known as detritus of plant and animal origin. Now, these microconsumers are bacteria and fungi which obtain energy and nutrients by decomposing dead organic substance, also known as detritus of plant and animal origin. Next, the products of decomposition such as organic and nutrients, which are released in the ecosystem, are reused by producers and thus recycled. I will again repeat it. The products of decomposition such as inorganic nutrients, which are released in the ecosystem, are reused by producers and thus recycled. Next, earthworm and certain soil organisms such as nematodes, N-E-M-A-T-O-D-E-S, and arthropods are detritus feeders and help in the decomposition of organic matter and are called detrivores. Now, classification of ecosystem. First, we will discuss natural ecosystem. Natural ecosystem is of two types. First is the terrestrial natural ecosystem. Next is aquatic natural ecosystem. Terrestrial natural ecosystem consists of forests, grasslands, and deserts. Aquatic natural ecosystem consists of freshwater, saline water, marine water. The detailed study of ecosystem will be dealt in the subsequent chapters. Now we'll discuss the goods and services provided by ecosystems. These goods and services are, first, provision of food, fuel and fiber. Next, provision of shelter and building materials. Next, purification of air and water. Next, detoxification and decomposition of wastes. Next, stabilization and moderation of Earth's climate. Next, moderation of floods, droughts, temperature extremes and forces of wind. Next, generation and renewal of soil fertility, including nutrient cycling. Next, pollination of plants, including many crops. Then, control of pests and diseases. Next, maintenance of genetic resources as key inputs to crop varieties and livestock breeds, medicines and other products. Next, cultural and aesthetic benefits. Now, we'll discuss what is an ecotone.
ECOTONE.
Now, ecotone is a zone of junction between two or more diverse ecosystem. For example, the mangrove forest represents an ecotone between marine and terrestrial ecosystem. Other examples are grassland, estuary, and riverbank. Now, characteristics of ecotone. First, it may be very narrow or quite wide. Second, it has the conditions intermediate to the adjacent ecosystems. Hence, it is a zone of tension. Next, third, it is linear as it shows progressive increase in species composition of one incoming community and a simultaneous decrease in species of the other outgoing adjoining community. Fourth, a well-developed ecotone contains some organisms which are entirely different from that of the adjoining communities. Fifth, sometimes the number of species and the population density of some of the species is much greater in this zone than either community. This is called edge effect. I will again repeat this important point. Sometimes the number of species and the population density of some of the species is much greater in this zone than either community. This is called edge effect. Now, the organisms which occur primarily or most abundantly in this zone are called edge species. In the terrestrial ecosystems, edge effect is especially applicable to birds. For example, the density of birds is greater in the mixed habitat of the ecotone between the forest and the desert. Now, we will discuss niche, N-I-C-H-E. What is niche? A niche is a unique functional role. Is a unique functional role or place of species in an ecosystem. It is a description of all the biological, physical, and chemical factors that a species needs to survive, stay healthy, and reproduce. A niche is unique for a species, which means no two species have exact identical niches. Niche plays an important role in conservation of organisms. If we have to conserve a species in its native habitat, we should have knowledge about the niche requirement of the species and should ensure that all requirements of its niche are fulfilled. Now, types of niche. First is the habitat niche. It is where it lives. Habitat niche, that is where that particular species lives. Next is food niche. That is what it eats or decomposes and what species it competes with. Next is reproductive niche, how and when it produces. Next is physical and chemical niche, that is temperature, land shape, land slope, humidity, and other requirement. Now we will discuss biome, that is the fifth organizational level in ecology, biomes. Now the terrestrial part of the biosphere is divisible into enormous regions called biomes, which are characterized by climate, vegetation, animal life, and general soil type. No two biomes are alike. The climate determines the boundaries of a biome and abundance of plants and animals found in each one of them. The most important climatic factors are temperature and precipitation. Some type of biomes are polar biome, tundra biome, boreal forest, then cold forest biome, prairie biome, temperate deciduous forest, then warm desert, then tropical grassland, then savanna, then tropical deciduous forest, then tropical rainforest, etc., etc. Now we'll discuss the types of biome, their region, and their flora and fauna. First, we'll discuss about the tundra biome. Tundra biome is the northernmost region adjoining the ice-bound poles. The flora and fauna there is devoid of trees, except some stunted shrubs in the southern part of the tundra biome are present. Also, some ground flora, which includes lichens, mosses, and sedges, S-E-D-G-E-S, are present. The typical animals are reindeer, R-E-I-N-D-E-E-R, then Arctic fox, then polar bear, then snowy owl, S-N-O-W-Y, snowy owl, then lemming, L-E-M-M-I-N-G, then Arctic hare, H-A-R-E, then ptarmigan, P-T-A-R-M-I-G-A-N, then reptiles and amphibians are almost absent in tundra biome. Next is taiga biome, T-A-I-G-A. द रीजन इज नॉर्दर्न यूरोप एशिया एंड नॉर्थ अमेरिका मॉडरेट टेम्परेचर देन टुंडरा इट इज ऑल्सो नोन एज बोरियल फॉरेस्ट. द फ्लोरा एंड फौना हेयर इज एज फॉलोज द डोमिनेटिंग वेजिटेशन इज कॉनिफेरस एवरग्रीन मोस्टली स्प्रूस SPRUCE विद सम पाइन एंड फिर्स FIRS. द फौना कंसिस्ट ऑफ स्मॉल सीड ईटिंग बर्ड्स हॉक्स फर बियरिंग कार्निवोर्स लिटिल मिंक MINK देन एल्क्स ELKS देन प्यूमा देन साइबेरियन टाइगर देन वोल्वरीन देन वोल्व्स एटसेट्रा. नेक्स्ट इज टेम्परेट डेसीड्यूस फॉरेस्ट. द रीजन ऑफ इट इज एक्सटेंड्स ओवर सेंट्रल एंड साउदर्न यूरोप ईस्टर्न नॉर्थ अमेरिका वेस्टर्न चाइना जापान न्यूजीलैंड एटसेट्रा मॉडरेट एवरेज टेम्परेचर एंड अबंडेंट रेनफॉल. दीज आर जनरली द मोस्ट प्रोडक्टिव एग्रीकल्चरल एरियाज ऑफ द अर्थ. द फ्लोरा इंक्लूड्स ट्रीज लाइक बीच BEECH ओक मैपल एंड चेरी. मोस्ट एनिमल्स आर द फैमिलियर वर्टिब्रेट्स एंड इनवर्टिब्रेट्स. नेक्स्ट कम्स ट्रॉपिकल रेन फॉरेस्ट बायोम. द रीजन ऑफ इट इज ट्रॉपिकल एरियाज इन द इक्विटोरियल रीजन्स विच इज अबाउंड विद लाइफ. टेम्परेचर एंड रेनफॉल इज हाई इन दिस रीजन. द फ्लोरा एंड फौना ऑफ ट्रॉपिकल रेन फॉरेस्ट इट कवर्स अबाउट 7% ऑफ द अर्थ सर्फेस एंड 40% ऑफ वर्ड्स प्लांट्स एंड एनिमल स्पेशीज. मल्टीपल स्टोरी ऑफ ब्रॉड लीव्ड एवरग्रीन ट्री स्पेशीज आर इन अबंडेंस. मल्टीपल स्टोरी of broad-leafed evergreen tree species are in abundance. Most animals and epiphytic plants are concentrated in the canopy or treetop zones. Most animals and epiphytic plants are concerned in the canopy or treetop zones. Now, what is an epiphyte? An epiphyte is a plant that grows harmlessly upon another plant such as a tree and derives its moisture and nutrients from the air, rain and sometimes from debris accumulating around it instead of the structure to which it is fastened. That is epiphytic plants which grow upon another plants and they derive their moisture and nutrients from air, rain and sometimes from the debris accumulated around it, but they do not take their nutrients from the trees on which they are growing. Next biome is the savanna biome, SAVANNAH. The region of it is tropical region. Savanna is most extensive in Africa continent. Now, flora and fauna of the savanna biome. It has grasses with scattered trees and fire-resistant thorny shrubs. The fauna includes a great diversity of grazers, GRA, ZERS, and browsers such as antelopes, buffaloes, zebras, elephants, and rhinoceros. The carnivores including lion, cheetah, hyena, HYENA, and the mongoose, and many rodents. Next is grassland biome. North America, Ukraine, etc. are the region in which grassland biome lies. They are dominated by grasses, temperate conditions with rather low rainfall are present in the grassland biomes. Flora and fauna are grasses dominate the vegetation. The fauna includes large herbivorous like bison, bison, antelope, cattle, rodents, wolves, prairie dog, and a rich and diverse array of ground nesting birds. Now the seventh type of biome is the desert. The region is continental interiors with very low and sporadic rainfall with low humidity. The days are very hot, but the nights are very cold. The days are very hot, but the nights are cold. Flora and fauna of this region is, the flora is drought-resistance vegetation, such as cactus, euphorbias, euphorbias, then sagebrush, sagebrush. Fauna consists of reptiles, mammals, and birds. Now we'll discuss about aquatic zones. Aquatic systems are called biomes. However, they are divided into distinct life zones with regions of relatively distinct plant and animal life. The major differences between the various aquatic zones are due to salinity, levels of dissolved nutrients, water temperature, depth of sunlight penetration. Now we'll discuss different types of aquatic ecosystem and their characteristics. The three broad type of aquatic ecosystems are, first is freshwater ecosystem, second is marine ecosystem, third is estuaries, E-S-T-U-A-R-I-E-S. Now we will discuss the characteristics of freshwater ecosystem.
First point. Freshwater ecosystems are classified as lotic, L-O-T-I-C, which is also known as moving water, or lentic, which is still or stagnant water. So they are divided into two broad categories, lotic, that is moving water, and lentic, which are still or stagnant water. Lotic water system includes freshwater, streams, springs, rivulets, R-I-V-U-L-E-T-S, then creeks, then brooks, creeks, C-R-E-E-K-S, brooks is B-R-O-O-K-S, and rivers. Lentic water, that is still or stagnant water bodies, include pools, ponds, some swamps, S-W-A-M-P-S. The Hindi of swamps is daldal, then bogs, B-O-G-S, and lakes. They vary considerably in physical, chemical, and biological characteristics. Next type of aquatic ecosystem is marine ecosystem. Nearly 3/4 of Earth's surface is covered by ocean. That is around 75%. With an average depth of 3,750 meters and with a salinity of 35 ppt, that is parts per thousand, about 90% of which is sodium chloride. I will again repeat this whole point. Nearly 3/4 of Earth's surface is covered by ocean. With an average depth of 3,750 meters and with salinity of 35 parts per thousand ppt, about 90% of which is sodium chloride. Next is estuaries. Characteristics are coastal bays, river mouths, and tidal marshes form the estuaries. In estuaries, fresh water from rivers meet ocean water and the two are mixed by the action of tides. Estuaries are highly productive as compared to the adjacent river or sea. Now we'll discuss biosphere. Biosphere is a part of the earth where life can exist. Biosphere represents a highly integrated and interacting zone comprising of atmosphere, that is air, then hydrosphere, that is water, and lithosphere, that is land. It is a narrow layer around the surface of the earth. If we visualize the earth to be the size of the apple, the biosphere would be as thick as its skin. Life in the biosphere is abundant between 200 meters, that is 660 feet below the surface of the ocean, and above 6,000 and about 6,000 meters, that is 20,000 feet above the sea level. Biosphere is absent at the extremes of the North and South Poles, the highest mountains and the deepest oceans, since existing hostile conditions there do not support life. Occasionally, spores, S-P-O-R-E-S, of fungi and bacteria do occur at great height, beyond 8,000 meters, but they are not metabolically active and hence represent only dormant life. The energy required for the life within the biosphere comes from the sun. The nutrients necessary for the living organisms comes from air, water, and soil. The same chemicals are recycled over and over again for life to continue. Living organisms are not uniformly distributed throughout the biosphere. Only a few organisms live in polar regions. While the tropical rainforests have an exceedingly rich diversity of plants and animals.